Good morning. Good morning to all of you, and welcome to those of you here in our sanctuary and those of you who are following the live stream on Facebook. For those of you on Facebook, just a reminder that you can find our worship leaflet on our website, standrewdenver.org. There's a supreme irony to the season of Advent. It's supposed to be a time of turning inward, a time of inward preparation to celebrate to both the coming of Jesus at Christmas and to also examine ourselves for the ways in which we are prepared for Jesus' second coming. And yet, for most people, it is the busiest time of the year. So I would invite you to basically make some time and some space for some turning inward and contemplation this Advent season. And now let us worship in the beauty of holiness.
Thank you. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be God's kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Sent your messengers, the prophets, to preach repentance and prepare the way for our salvation. Give us grace to heed their warnings and forsake our sins, that we may greet with joy the coming of Jesus, our Redeemer, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. A reading from the book of Isaiah. Comfort, O comfort ye my people, says your God.
Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries out, "In the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken." A voice says, "Cry out." And I said, "What shall I cry?" All people are grass. Their constancy is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades when the breath of the Lord blows upon it. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Get you up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good tidings. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good tidings. Lift it up, do not fear. Say to the cities of Judah, "Here is your God." See, the Lord God comes with might, and his arm rules for him. His reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms and carry them in his bosom and gently lead the mother sheep. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. A reading from the second letter of Peter. Do not ignore this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like one day. The Lord is not slow about his promise, as some think of slowness, but is patient with you, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a loud noise, and the elements will be dissolved with fire, and the earth and everything that is done on it will be disclosed. Since all these things are to be dissolved in this way, what sort of persons ought you to be in leading lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set ablaze and dissolved, and the elements will melt with fire? But, in accordance with his promise, we wait for new heavens and a new earth, where righteousness is at home. Therefore, beloved, while you are waiting for these things, strive to be found by him at peace, without spot or blemish, and regard the patience of our Lord as salvation. The word of the Lord.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the prophet Isaiah, "See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way. The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make his paths straight." John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I recently became aware of an Advent theme poem entitled, How Does a Weary World Rejoice? If that title sounds familiar, it's because it's taken from the Christmas carol known in English as O Holy Night, one of my personal favorites. It's a pertinent question to ask as we prepare to celebrate the Christmas season. How does indeed a weary world rejoice? Weary is a fitting way to describe the current state of our world, along with dejected, perhaps horrified, and even somewhat scared. I won't bore you with yet another recitation of why we may feel one or more of those emotions, because I'm sure you don't need me to. Some days it seems like so many of the certainties we take for granted are on somewhat shaky ground, and long-term uncertainty is known to be emotionally draining. No wonder we all feel so weary. In a recent conversation I had with a parishioner, she commented that there are two reasons to come to church: inspiration to go out there and make a difference in the world, and healing from the wounds that everyday life inflicts on us. Her observation was that right now, a lot of us seem to really need healing. The same might be said for Jesus' own historical context, but for different reasons. The time immediately before and during his life was one of violence and great instability. Herod the Great, who died shortly after Jesus' birth, ruled Palestine with an iron fist. And as often happens, all that suppressed resentment and hatred simply exploded after his death. His son, Herod Archelaus, who ruled Judea, tried to assert his control with the help of the Roman garrison in Jerusalem, but they failed. He was removed by Rome, and Judea came under direct Roman rule in 6 CE. The fear that temple worship would be banned and the temple itself desecrated or even destroyed by Rome's army gripped all of Judea. This fear was present throughout Jesus' life. Perhaps this is why so many went out to the wilderness to hear what John the Baptist had to say. The situation in Galilee, ruled by Herod Antipas, another of Herod's sons, wasn't any better. Violent religious nationalist movements like the Zealots, were formed. False messiahs gained fame, and one led a rebellion in Sepphoris, only 6 miles from Nazareth, during Jesus' adolescence. It was brutally put down by Roman forces. The city was burned, many of its inhabitants captured and sold into slavery, and the leaders of the revolt were crucified. Sepphoris was a major city, an economic center. It was where tradespeople, such as carpenters, went to drum up business. And so its destruction was a blow to the entire area. And we have to wonder, did those invading troops plunder the surrounding area? Towns like Nazareth? Did these events cause Galilean men like Jesus to travel to Judea to see and hear John the Baptist, to hear his message and be cleansed in the Jordan River? Galilean men entering Judea came under suspicion, especially at times like Passover. Men like John and Jesus provoked fear in the Roman and temple authorities at all times. This is the weary world Jesus was born into. Weary of oppression, weary of rebellions, weary of Roman retaliation, and weary of the suffering of those caught in the middle. Weary of the cloud of fear under which everyone lived. Our time and Jesus' time are not so different in some respect. Our weariness has an element of fear in it as well. But of course, in many other ways, our time is very, very different. Those of us living comfortable lives are accustomed to a high degree of security, safety, and prosperity. And that confers on us a measure of control over our lives that previous generations could only dream about. Baby boomers such as myself were born in a time of prosperity. And growing up, we expected prosperity to continue on a steady upward trajectory. Our culture has a strong element of consumerism with a bias towards immediate gratification. But these high expectations that we have make us vulnerable. We are shocked and destabilized when safety, security, and prosperity are threatened. We have a faulty understanding of hope. We think it means that if things are not as we wish them to be, well, they will be soon. Mostly, we fail to realize how exceptional our expectations are. Past generations did not necessarily expect a constant upward trajectory or immediate gratification. So, how does our weary world rejoice? It can be found in the key word of the Advent season, hope. The full lyric of O Holy Night is, "A thrill of hope, a weary world rejoices." That's what Jesus came into the world to bring, a thrill of hope. And that is what we need to sustain us. In a general sense, hope is tied to expectation, a desire for certain things to happen. For the Israelites, hope was rooted in the expectation of the Messiah, a liberator who would free them from oppression. For Christians, hope is rooted in God through Christ. God sent the Son into the world to preach the coming of the kingdom of God, a kingdom that could not be more different from the world's understanding of kings and their power. Its power is love. Mark's gospel is entitled The Beginning of the Good News, in Greek, the Evangelion of Jesus Christ. Evangelion is the kind of news an imperial messenger would bring, usually a victory in battle. In the rest of the gospel, the good news is a different kind of victory, that the kingdom of God has come near in Jesus and is inaugurated by the resurrection of Jesus from the dead. That promise of eternal life, that promise of our own resurrection, is the source of our hope. The resurrection of Jesus also inaugurated the beginning of the end time, when all creation will be perfected. Our hope in all these things is our anchor in the stormy seas of life. It is a source of patient endurance as we wait in the tension of the already and not yet character of the kingdom. So if there is one phrase to describe this good news, it is indeed a thrill of hope. Advent isn't just a time of preparation for the celebration of God coming into the world as baby Jesus. It is also a time to remind ourselves of what we are waiting for, that in a sense, the best is yet to come, despite the trials and tribulations that we experience in the world, personally and collectively. Advent is the time to remind ourselves that however discouraging we may find the state of the world, we have every reason to be optimistic. We have a great hope, a cosmic hope, to cling to, even if it may not be fulfilled in our time. It runs counter to our desire for instant gratification, but this hope is far more real and certainly more lasting. The source of our hope is the victory of Jesus over sin and death. And therefore, we can be certain that whatever evil human beings choose to inflict on one another, God's love will triumph in the end. And so we're reminded in this season to take a stance of purposeful waiting, which Jesus described in so many parables, especially the ones we heard toward the end of the Pentecost season. Keep awake, care for one another, because our actions can brighten or dim hope for others. Living out the way of Jesus brings us closer to God and strengthens hope. Living the way of Jesus reminds us that though the ultimate perfection of creation is in God's hands, not ours, and it will happen in God's time, it is a sure and certain hope. So let's trust in that thrill of hope. Let us rejoice in the entrance of God into history in Jesus and in the hope of his return. I'd like to end with the poem that inspired this sermon by Sarah Speed. How does a weary world rejoice? I think delayed Christmas cards count. The ones with the haphazard stamps mailed 3 weeks late. I think the way you get down on all fours to be close to your dog and your cousin's baby counts. It's a holy routine. I think the way you stretch your body awake and breathe deeply when you rise counts. That's Yahweh in your lungs. I think the extra second you spent looking at the sky last night and not being afraid to dance counts. So does giving up your seat on the subway for someone's grandfather, helping her carry the stroller up the stairs, and running to catch the man who dropped his bag in the crosswalk. Lighting candles when the sun disappears, laughing so hard others begin to stare, and pausing to look at trees every once in a while to say, "Good job with that one, God." All definitely counts. As do mumbled prayers and children's prayers and every measure of music. How does a weary world rejoice? I would guess soul by soul and day by day. But if you ask me, I bet most all of it counts. Amen. those desiring a blessing on the occasion of a birthday, anniversary, or some other reason, or who desires it for another, are invited to come forward at this time.
The prayers of the people are found in the service bulletin. In joyful expectation of his coming to our aid, we pray to Jesus. In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the Church of Pakistan United. In the diocesan circle of prayer, we pray for All Saints in the Mountains Mission in Crested Butte, the Church of the Holy Comforter in Broomfield, Sudanese Community Church in Denver, and our diocesan deputation to General Convention. Help us to live in the light of your coming and give us a longing for your kingdom. Come to your world as King of the nations. We pray for the leaders of the nations and for all in authority. Grant that all leaders may follow the path of justice and the way of peace. Come to the suffering as Savior and Comforter. We pray for Roberta Cisneros, Libby Artinson, for Shane, Kathy, Sally Bartolot, George Hoover, Scott, Evans Wright family, Father Don Warner, Brian, Maya Fernandez, Ryan, Kent, JP, Jerry, the Ukrainian people, the peoples of Israel and Palestine. Break into our lives where we struggle with sickness and distress, and set us free to serve you forever. Come to us as shepherd and guardian of our souls. We remember Julian Rush and Bonnie Clausen, and those who have died this week as victims of disease, war, gun violence, natural disasters, abuse, and neglect, and those who mourn. Give us, with all the faithful departed, a share in your victory over evil and death. Come from heaven, Lord Jesus, with power and great glory. Lift us up to meet you, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Andrew, our patron, and all your saints and angels, we may live and reign with you in your new creation. Come, Lord Jesus. Come to us, Lord Jesus, as inspiration and guide. We pray in thanksgiving for those celebrating birthdays or anniversaries this week. We pray for the ministries in which we serve God here. We pray for our own needs and those of others, naming aloud or silently those for whom we have a special concern. We pray for St. Andrew's and its ministries as we continue in our call to offer sanctuary in the city, grow in God's love, and seek the renewal of the world. Bless and guide the Vestry and Rector Search Committee, that their work may be grounded in the vision and identity of our parish community. Help us to be a blessing to one another and to others.
Hasten, O Father, the coming of your kingdom, and grant that we, your servants, who now live by faith, may with joy behold your Son at his coming in glorious majesty, even Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. Amen. This morning, Michaela is asking for, well, is raising prayers of gratitude for a successful knee replacement surgery. So if you would please join me. Almighty God, we entrust all
your dear to us, to your never-failing care and love. For this life and life to come, for all the ages of the world, knowing you are doing for them better things than we can desire or pray for, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Let us confess our sins to God. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through the grace of Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Please be seated for a few announcements. Just a reminder that communion is open to all. Those of you desiring to drink from the common cup may come to this side of the church at communion, and those of you desiring to have your wafer dipped or intincted should come to this side of the church. Also, one quick announcement. This afternoon at 5:30, we'll be celebrating a service of Advent lessons and carols with lots of beautiful music, and I hope to see you there.
Good morning. Next Sunday at 3 p.m. is our service of healing during the Advent season. So if this is a season that isn't so much fun for you and you actually dread it, then this is a good time to come and just hear some beautiful music, have some opportunity for silence, some readings. If you just need a time just to do something completely different rather than run around town, this would be a great opportunity to do that. So we'd love to see you here then. Thank you.
Good morning. You guys are better than the 9 o'clock. You're probably more awake. Today's the day. If you pulled a tag from the giving tree out in the narthex on the porch, I call it, and have not yet brought it back, you have however many hours between now and lessons and carols to go home, get it, make sure you attach it securely to an unwrapped present, and bring it back. Because there really is a person that asked specifically for that gift who is waiting for it. So thanks very much.
At this time of offering, walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Joyful thing, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because you sent your beloved Son to redeem us from sin and death, and to make us heirs on him of everlasting life. That when he shall come again in power and great triumph to judge the world, we may without shame or fear rejoice to behold his appearing. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your words spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the Word made flesh, Jesus, your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him, you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for the many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. We remember his death. We proclaim his resurrection. We await his coming in glory. And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from this, your creation, this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and the blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection unto your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country, where, with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Andrew our patron, and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of all your children. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. As our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. Father, who art in heaven, Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us eat the feast. Alleluia.
O
the gifts of God for the people of God. Behold who you are and become what you receive.
Sean, in the name of God, we send you now to share communion with those who are absent from this table. As you have been fed, now feed others in Christ's name. Our prayers are with you. Go in peace.
Thanks be to God.
Please join in our post-communion prayer. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the Sun of Righteousness shine upon you and scatter the darkness before your path, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.
The glory of the Lord shall be revealed.
Amen.